Okay. Hi there. I'm Nick Crichton. I'm the Director of Indigenous Engagement with Saskatchewan Chamber of Commerce. And today, we're fortunate to have with you Jacob, or our Jake Sinclair. He is the owner and president of Anytime Fitness here in Regina. How are you doing, Jake?
Doing good. How are you doing?
Good, man. Good, good, good. I've been able to pivot, make the adjustment, and working from home. I see you got some time in the, you were able to go in the gym, even though I'm sure it's closed down right now.
Yeah.
So, how long now have you been the, how long you and your, cause I know that you're working with your wife and you guys are, owners of the Anytime Fitness. How long has that been?
It's been almost a year. So we took over all the clubs in Regina. So, but we've been shut down for one full month today. So yeah. We've been hitting lots of obstacles since we've taken over, it's been fun and exciting, and a lot of ups and downs, just like every entrepreneur, especially during these times.
Yeah, no kidding. Oh, and I forgot when I introduced you too, and I, not that this is super important, but you're a really big, like, unfortunately, you're a big Calgary Flames fan, which
I sure am,
which doesn't make much sense. But I mean, we'll say they won the cup, because I think, what did they have a cup win, right? 89? Was it 89?
Yeah, 89.
Yeah. Were you born in
89? Years one.
Yeah.
No, I was born in 90.
90.
I like to say that I was conceived during one of those nights during a Ryder win or a Calgary Flames fan. Or Calgary Flames win.
It was a good year for sports locally, I guess, hey?
Yeah.
Back in those days, yeah. So yeah, I don't know why. One day you'll change your mind. You'll figure it out that Calgary's not that good of a team. You get along well with my dad. He's from Calgary, and my brother, they're Calgary Flames fans. Everybody else is Calgary or Edmonton Oilers for some odd reason. But anyways, I won't hold that against you.
They've been undefeated now for almost 6 weeks, so.
Yeah, of course they have. There you go. Can't say that very often, but yeah, no, for sure.
Yeah,
no, they're young. We'll see. Who knows what the season will look like here in the next couple of months. But not top of mind. But anyways, before we talk about you and Anytime Fitness, as you know, owning that for over a year now, which is, you know, congratulations to you and your wife on that. Let's go a little bit back, because you're originally from George Gordon First Nation. You grew up there and you went to high school at Raymore. Mm-hmm. So tell me a little bit about what's that like and kind of what got you into this field of fitness and improving your physical activity and all of that kind of stuff.
Raised in Gordons, born in Regina, moved out to Gordons in 96, I believe. I really liked hockey was my favorite sport, and golf and hockey and track and occasionally ball when I was a little bit younger, but hockey was kind of my first love. And so I liked being active. I liked jogging and putting in hard work. And I wasn't really a runner, but hockey made me a runner. Mm-hmm. So I started joining the track teams and the cross country teams, and I kind of just taken on a whole life of activity. And in 2004, I moved to Raymore High School. And so Raymore was one of the high schools I was available. I went to school with the George Gordon, went to Punichai, but I decided to go to Raymore. There was no buses for us to get out there. So there's a small group of us from Gordons that used to commute and travel together. And when I got there, I played hockey. So I played hockey in Raymore. So it was I knew some of the guys there already, some of the people. And I joined the cross country team. And so one of the things that I really, one of the few people, I think there was like six of us in total, joined the cross country team. And I fell in love with running. And I met this pretty girl during the cross country team. So kept me motivated to keep me in there and keep me running. And she actually just lived off the reserve. So George Gordon was really close to her farm. And so we used to, there's a well, and it was 8 kilometers for me to get there. And I think it was about near the same or even more for her to get there. So we used to meet and we used to run to the well and meet each other. So it was just off the reserve.
Nice. And do our parents know about this? Do your parents know or knew that you guys were sneaking around?
Yeah, well, we did it in communicating with them, because this was pre-iPhone with with no tracking. So I'd let them know saying, hey, it's 4 o'clock in the afternoon on Saturday. I'm going to go meet this girl at the well. If I don't come back within a couple hours, come send a search party, I guess. But it was a very populated road that I ran down. So, anyways, fast forward, I ended up marrying that girl. So we've been dating ever since 2005. And him, my wife, my business partner, and we just kind of always loved fitness. We you know, running brought us together, and it just kind of, it fit well when the opportunity came to get into, you know, this business. And prior to us even, you know, becoming owners, we were also members of this gym. So, you know, we loved, you know, the community that was already here. So that's kind of what brought us into fitness. And that's kind of, you know, kind of guided us thus far on a personal level.
Oh, right on. That's awesome, man. That's a really cool story. That's going to be fun. I don't know if you guys have plans or if what your plans are to have kids one day, or that's going to be the plan in your guys' future, but
it's
definitely a cool story that you can definitely tell your kids that you guys used to run. You guys loved each other so much. You used to run 8 kilometers to see her. So that's cool, man.
Yeah.
That's awesome. So before we get into Anytime Fitness and where you at, like, what kind of motivated you go there? Because I see that you worked at as a operations or junior manager operations you're a co-owner at Regina Beach at one of the golf courses there at Kanukuma, I'm guessing.
Yeah. So my career kind of took me all over the place. I've seen on Facebook a lot of people are doing these quarantine riddles. You know, here's a list of the 15 jobs that I had. And, you know, one of them is false. And I've done so much work. I've always have something on the go. And so those were some of the things that I've done in the past that, So I have, previous owner of Regina Beach Golf Course. I very passionate about sports, obviously. So when the Regina 2014 North American Indigenous Games came to town, I used to run. So I was a past participant and medalist for the Saskatchewan, for the North American Indigenous Games team, SASC. Right. I ran in Denver. And when the opportunity came to join them, I jumped at it. And it was a really neat experience being involved with games when they were here and promoting sport and working with the youth. I'm really passionate about helping other people, especially Indigenous people. So it was just a good fit, and it kind of moved me into that career path of really helping people, not on a fitness side, but also on other areas where my career took me after that.
Right on. And what kind of got you into golf? Because I know that I've golfed with you, and I don't want to golf with you anymore. I actually don't want to bet you on golf because you're too damn good, but you make it seem so seamless. So what kind of got you, led you down that path of, you know, being an excellent golfer, and then also not only golf, but I'm sure you're a great runner considering you're a medalist and all that kind of stuff, and at a high level. So what kind of got you into
that?
What kind of got you into golf or wanting to be a golfer?
My family is big golfers on my dad's side. So my dad was one of the first in Canada. I think he was one of the first Indigenous professionals, but in Saskatchewan, he was the first. I know that one. So I think he was the second in all of Canada being CPGA certified. And I think he was the first in Saskatchewan. So he was a big golfer. So obviously, his influence, you know, as far as business and as far as golfing, kind of rubbed off on me. My grandfather was also a golfer, and both my grandfathers. So my golf course, you know, every single Father's Day, we'd go out and we would have a round together and things like that. And being being active at a young age gave me a good drive. So I always got picked up on these teams for scrambles, being a young person who could hit the ball far. And I liked it. And, it was really neat to not only be in that business, but also, after I had a stressful day, it was really neat just to get out and hit the range or something like that, or go for a round.
Nice.
So yeah, I haven't been golfing so much lately. I've been just a little bit busy, but, I was very passionate about it and moving forward. And when it was time to move away from that venture, I was comfortable moving away from it. The passion kind of wore off on the seasonal business being here in Saskatchewan.
Yeah.
So it was really difficult to, But yeah, nonetheless, it was a fun endeavor. And you know, I still golf to this day, not as much as I'd like to, but I had big plans this summer, but I guess we're going to be locked indoors all summer. So
yeah, they're not opening up courses.
Yeah,
no kidding. Hey, geez, but you've been busy since you hired me. I remember as a workforce development coordinator with George Gordon at their urban office there for a couple months before I went on to the city. But looking at your resume and the stuff that you're telling me, I was like, man, I felt lazy compared to how much certifications you have. You're a certified trainer. You have like you certify people in like first aid, all that kind of stuff. What's always giving you that drive? Because I know you talked a little bit about, you know, how sports has kind of always pushed you in running and all those kinds of things. But what kind of, what's helped motivate you to keep getting certifications and keep adding to your, I guess, your skill set and your abilities for your career?
The certifications are kind of one-offs. It wasn't a goal of mine to get certified in anything like that. I just like learning. I like being in a position where I could be to learn. So I'm always, you know, whether it is right now, actually, I'm still at the U of R, you know, still doing a lot of things actively involved with the U of R, part of two cohorts there. So I have another advanced leadership certificate program that I got to participate in next week sometime. So I've always liked learning and then when the opportunity came up, you know, you're pretty smart in this area. Why don't you feel about teaching? So I just, yeah, what is it, you know, what do I got to do? And just went ahead and did it. And, you know, it also gave me the opportunity to not only teach myself, but also teach others. So I'm very big on, you know, teaching others and leaving them as a better person than when they were introduced to me. So I like enhancing people and bringing out the better of them. And yeah, that's kind of what motivates me.
That's awesome, man. No, that's definitely really cool. And I remember even when I was working with you for a brief time there, you even ran fitness classes back in your home community.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. We used to go out there twice a week. We do Wednesdays and Sundays, and my wife and I would go out, put fitness classes out there. And it was very fun, but also at the same time, you know, Gordon's is an hour and a half away or hour away, depends how fast you drive. And, you know, it just kind of became tiresome. And the wear and tear on our vehicle, but we'd still love the opportunity to go back and do that to, you know, not only my community, but other communities as well. Time permitting, that's the one thing. So,
yeah, no kidding. Yeah. Now you own the business, you own the gym. Now they got to get them to come to the city, to your gym, right?
Yeah. So the gym is a 24-hour gym. It's we're never closed. So our doors are always open. And the one thing about operating a 24-hour gym is that I was going to be on standby for 24 hours. So it's never ending. And for us to kind of sneak away sometimes is almost, you know, impossible, because you're the owner, you take care of everything. You're doing payroll, you're doing the books, you're doing, you know, if there's a spill happens, if you need to change the light bulb, you're the janitor, you're everything. So, you know, the flexibility isn't there as much as it like to be to go and do community events again. But we, you know, if the opportunity came, I'd jump at it just to get out there. I think we've seen a lot of positive results of my community of you know, a lot of people getting active and getting fit and, you know, seeing people transform.
Yeah, that's exactly kind of what you're looking for, right? Is and kudos to you and your wife for starting something like that, getting right into it. I mean, it makes perfect sense that you decided that you were going to go into that and open up or purchase and become the owner of a gym with your wife because of how active you were. I want to talk a little bit though. I see, and I didn't notice that you worked for 10 years at First Medics Saskatchewan. What exactly did you do at First Medics Saskatchewan? What was that about? You spent 10 years as a director.
That was another business venture. Okay. It didn't really take off as much as we planned. This year we actually just formally shut it down. We did first aid. That was where my first aid came from, my first aid training.
Okay, that makes sense.
Yeah, so we did a lot of you know, supplying medical staff and medical supplies to remote, you know, mines, communities, and it didn't take off the way we'd hoped. You know, competing against the public market, you know, having you know, health regions and all that kind of stuff for services are offered for free. Nobody really wants to pay us to do it, so it didn't take off the way it hoped, but What led to that is, in 2011, early 2011 is when we started it. It was actually my father and I. And so I kind of wanted to kind of keep on going that, because later on in 2011, my father passed away. And so we've just been trying to keep on and keep that going, but it just didn't turn out the way we wanted to. But yeah, it was fun. It was, we learned a lot, you know, a lot of trips to Alberta. Alberta was kind of the hotspot for that. And I've always kind of had that on the back burner, and trying to promote that business, but at the same time, trying not to have any conflict of interest with the other things that I got going on. So it was always a juggling act on where do I try to push that and try to not have any conflicts of interest with anything else that I got going on.
Yeah, no kidding. Yeah. You're a very busy guy. And what helps, I guess, talking about how busy you are, do you have mentors or anything that you turn to? Or does anybody help you out in the business world? Because you're now, you know, you've been an entrepreneur almost your whole life. It kind of seems like a good fit for you, obviously, to be a business owner. But, you know, has there anybody been, you know, beside you or anybody that you can thank for, you know, being a mentor that helped you out along the way?
I don't have anybody really, you know, I don't have one mentor that I could really attribute to all my success and you know, getting over some obstacles. So I have many mentors. So I look up to a lot of people, and they don't really think that they're my mentor, but at the back, you know, I kind of watch the way that they lead, and I take cues from them. So obviously my parents are big mentors in my life, my mom, my dad. My dad was an entrepreneur, so I just try to think of things that he would say, and I try to remember the things that he said back when he was running the businesses. And read a lot of books. So a lot of, you know, authors and business people that are out there, I think of them as mentors as well. And then as well as, you know, very successful people in the city of Regina, you know, the province of Saskatchewan, of course. And, you know, near and far, I kind of look up to a lot of people and try to learn from their mistakes. But I don't have one in particular. You know, changed my life around, this person kind of did this for me. Not yet. So I hope, you know, hopefully in the future I have this somebody that kind of just gives me an aha moment, and, you know, we just really dial in and you know, crush some big goals and help more people. But you know, right now I draw a lot from a lot of people at the moment.
All right, on, that's awesome. And I think that's the, for a lot of people, that's kind of, isn't just that one person. If there's a lot, you know, and a lot of people use their support, their family. I mean, you've been with your wife now, you know, for a very long time. So, and you guys have seemed like you guys have the same kind of goals, and you're both very driven people to continue something like this. So let's get to Anytime Fitness. Like, what do you remember the moment when you were talking to your wife on when you guys decided, like, this is what we're going to do? We actually were patrons at this gym. Like, what was that moment for you guys that you decide, you know what, we're going to save the money, or we're going to invest, or we want to purchase this? Like, what happened? What happened for you there?
It was a buildup of moments, I think. My working career and my wife's working career, we both worked for the province for almost 8 years in different ministries. But so she was kind of at wit's end with her current path. And she was like, there's very few, you know, there's advancement, but not the advancement that she was looking for. And so, you know, we would come home and we're exploring options on what to do. We knew we wanted to go into business together. And we thought about a gym a while back, but, you know, we thought that the market for it right now wouldn't make sense for us to open up a brand new gym just with all the competition going on and all that. And so when the opportunity came to purchase the gym, you know, my wife just kind of said it in passing. And I just got on the phone with the owner within the half hour. I talked to him for about 3 hours, and it was just a spiral of events. So it was, you know, since that conversation, the next week I hammered out a business plan, you know, secured, I tried to secure as much of grant funding as I possibly could to not take the big impact on my, you know, on my personal finances, and just trying to line up everything. Not only that, but I guess we, you know, when I'm involved in so many things that I'm involved in, trying to line up my life as well. So it was also another obstacle. And then, you know, since then we had to jump through a lot of hoops. I'm not too sure if, you know, a lot of the other entrepreneurs that you spoke to, that there's always obstacles. You know, I thought it was going to be a two person deal. there was about 50 people involved in that. So it was was nonstop going back and forth, and it was, you know, we set, everything was all set up, but in order to get to jump through a lot of hoops, you have to bring in more and more people. So it was a process, but yeah, we had to travel down because it's a franchise. We had to go take the mandatory 2-week training. So we had to travel down to Minneapolis and stay in Minneapolis for a couple weeks. And yeah, the entire time, even though we did that trip and we completed the training, everything still wasn't for sure. We kind of held our breath until the last minute, just because everything that involved in that deal took a long time to kind of pull off. So, you know, we took a lot of risk on you know, going on leave from our jobs and commuting out there. And so before even day one, so trying to line up everything. But yeah, so we didn't really have a, you know, it was probably about a 4-month process for us to get through everything that we kind of got through. So it was even, you know, there wasn't no moment. It was a buildup of a lot of moments. And in any given moment, I was just, you know, we were saying, well, it might fall through, you know, well, now we're back on path and it's going to work out even better for us. So it was a lot of going back and forth, but yeah, it was a process. There was no one moment.
Oh, not, I can only imagine, man. That's a huge undertaking, and kudos to you and your wife for taking something like that on, because it's a lot of work. And I can, yeah, being open 24 hours a day and being on call, man, I don't think I can do that. I don't think I can be on call at 3 in the morning. I mean, I have a little one who's 2 who used to wake me up in the middle of the night, and it was tough, man. It was tough. So the fact that you're on call and then you probably have to go run out to your gym if something happens. I remember when you showed me around there, because you were working on some stuff. I think you guys had some flooding in the East End, I believe, and I'm sure that was a problem. And I think you found out, if I remember correctly, you guys were on vacation and you found out about that. So lots of things to consider as a business owner, hey?
Yeah, we had a we were across the world, and we just landed at midnight on Sunday, and then we found out at 6 a.m. So 6-hour nap after, you know, spending almost probably about 36 hours awake, just of, well, maybe even longer than that. I think we didn't sleep since Friday, and then that was Sunday. So we had to, I can't sleep on planes, and so we had to fly over the seas, and then we landed, and then got a you know, a message saying that there's some water. Went over there and realized, yeah, it was a flood. So it was, I said, if we survive this year, nothing's going to take us down, because this year has been all kinds of obstacles. And not only for us, but a lot of, you know, a lot of entrepreneurs, and not only Canada, Saskatchewan, but, you know, the entire world.
Yeah, no kidding. So, geez, hey, but what was that? Where did you go? That was 36 hours away. Like, where were you flying to the moon? Like, where? Like,
from that flight, oh geez, I'm trying to remember how we got home, but it was from London London to Toronto, and then, or no, to Halifax and Toronto, and then Calgary, and then home. So it was kind of all over the place. But I think we started off, we left Scotland. We were so it was like 6 connections later, and we arrived home.
You made it home. Jeez, hey, yeah. What kind of news? That's some crazy news to get when you're on vacation. I can't even imagine, especially because you were at that point. It was pretty fresh in terms of, like, you guys, you know, owning that place, right? So owning Anytime Fitness.
Yeah, it was a pipe break from the neighbor next door, and, you know, you can't do anything about it. And yeah, it was lucky. I'm kind of handy, and I was wishing I could, you know, just bang it out in the weekend and get everybody back and working out in there. But it took a little bit longer too, as another process. But yeah. Series of processes.
Yeah, it sounds like it, man. So before we wrap up here, Jake, and I appreciate all the, you know, you taking the time, because I know you're, you know, busy and you're a business owner and stuff like that. But do you have any advice, because for anybody that's interested in starting, anybody who wants to start their own business or go out and be an entrepreneur, because I know that you're driven, you have the motivation and all of that. But if you have any piece of advice, that would be really great. And the reason I bring that up is because I think we're in the era, right? We're in that era of everybody wants to be, they see the shine of being an entrepreneur on Instagram, or being an entrepreneur on, you know, with the shiny cars and all that kind of stuff, but they don't realize what happens in order to get to those places. So do you have any advice that you can give to anybody that's looking to start a business?
Yeah, I you know, just making sure that you're passionate about it, because the passion's going to wear off at, you know, if you're up at 3 a.m. continuing working and you're not getting paid for anything, that is passion. So making sure that you're passionate about whatever you're trying to accomplish as an entrepreneur, and, you know, making sure that you have enough drive to get to that next point, because it's an uphill battle. It's never stopping. And it, you know, you think you're going to be coasting, and then COVID-19 hits and then kind of just hits you blindsided. So, you know, there's going to be much more obstacles. You know, COVID-19 is just one of them. There's going to be many more that are going to be coming. So, you know, it's just whatever you do, just making sure that you're passionate about it. And, you know, you have, you know, so much technology at your disposal. So it's very, you know, if you don't use the computer to your advantage, a Google search to try to figure out what your market's like and try to figure out how to do something that you don't know how to do, you know, entrepreneurship might not be for you if you can't use the computer effectively to try to search out how to accomplish a task or how to contact somebody that knows how to accomplish this task. So being resourceful and courteous and disciplined of your time, and that's a big one. So making sure that you're disciplined and also courteous with your time for yourself, and making sure that you don't burn out. But I think passion is the one big thing that's going to get you through all of that.
Right on, man. No, that's some really good advice. And I do appreciate you, you know, laying that out, because, you know, what I was talking about before is you're absolutely, you know, you're right. People don't see the grinding part of it. You know what I mean? The grinding of being up at 3 a.m. or being on vacation, you know, taking time to go on vacation, and then your pipe bursts, so you then have to come back. And yeah, that's sometimes the part of it that they don't see. They just see your name in front of Anytime Fitness, or they see your name in front of Business X or whatever the case may be. And, you know, they see all the glitz and glam, but they don't know, you know, what happens behind the scenes that comes into it. And, you know, because
even when we were on vacation, you don't really get a vacation. I didn't have the luxury of unplugging. I still had to do payroll. I still had to handle operations from a computer from, you know, the other side of the world. I still had to customer inquiries and making sure that our team back home was all set up. And, you know, I said, we're always a phone call away. And, you know, because of that, we weren't really as present as we could be in our vacation. So it was long overdue. It was actually our honeymoon. So we right. figured we had it planned out before we even bought the gym. So it wasn't going back on it. And we're glad we did. Otherwise, you know, Europe is going to look much different in 2020 than it did in 2019 prior to the virus. So we were lucky to experience all that before everything went through. But yeah, so there's, like I said, there's a lot of grinding, a lot of grinding. And it's still to this day, even though we're shut down, we don't have any customers in here, we revamped everything. So it's just a lot of hard work. And the only thing that kind of gets you through that is passion and making sure that your heart's still in it.
That's, yeah, it's very good information, very good advice. So tell me a little bit about how they can, how can people reach, you know, where is Anytime Fitness located? I'm familiar with it, but maybe for the audience who wants to see this video.
So I own two locations. One of them is on Rochdale. That's where I'm right now, is on Rochdale. It is right across from the YMCA-ish area, right by McDonald's near the end of Rochdale, 6250 Rochdale. Our other location is on the east end of Regina. It's Prince of Wales. It's 3115 Woodhams. It's kind of on the corner of Prince of Wales and Arcola near there. So two locations. We're very active on Facebook and Instagram. Those are two social media platforms where most of our followers interact with us, and a lot of our members are. So at Anytime Fitness Regina, both of them are us. So whatever one you want to click on Facebook or Instagram, that's both us, and that's managed by myself, my wife, and two of our other team members. So we're always on there. Like I said, it's never ending, because on social media, you might get a message at 3 a.m. and saying the door doesn't want to open because it's minus 40 outside, and it's warm in the inside and cold on the outside. So then you got to race over here and open up the door for somebody at 3 a.m. or, you know, all kinds of obstacles of being a 24-hour gym.
Yikes. Yeah, I know. I'm sure your phone's up, your volume's up high, and your phone's always charged. It's crazy.
Yeah, yeah.
I was going to say something else, but I kind of slipped my mind. anyways, no, I appreciate you. I was going to ask, now that you guys, how has that transition been now that the gym, like, are you guys offering online or virtual classes, or what are some of the, you know, what are some ways that you guys kind of have to innovate, you know, being gym owners?
The first week was kind of, we're blindsided, but the week leading up to the state of emergency by Saskatchewan, we're kind of anticipating that we're going to be closing. We just didn't know when. And so each day members were asking us, can you stay open? Can you stay open? You know, we're going to do our best to stay open for you guys. And then the big box gyms closed in Regina, you know, the major ones, we had a lot of their members try to come to us. And we just said, no, we're just going to be just for our members only. And we are going to, just service our members. We're just going to focus on that. So we didn't take any, we had an opportunity to probably take another 100 members in, but that flood of people would have shut us down for sure. So we said, no, we're just going to maintain. And as soon as that first, you know, that first week hit, and we kind of went into, I don't want to say a depression, but, what now? What do we do? So during that time, we actually just renovated our north facility. So we painted the entire club. We arranged things. We remodeled our bathrooms and our change rooms. So we brought in some more equipment. So our north facility is going to look similar but different, enhanced, I guess. So we try to spend a lot of time there. And then on the back end, so we did a lot of back end things that nobody will notice but us. It's going to make our systems a little bit busier or easier. So we did that. And then as far as online, we were able to sell sweaters, t-shirts, supplements, all that kind of stuff. But then once our supply ran short, our suppliers are not working right now either, so we can't even get any new supplies in. And then as far as going online, there's a liability for us, as if we conduct something online and somebody has a heart attack at their house, we might be liable. So we're trying to tread that and try to figure out how to go around that. We're going to be on CTV next week. So we'll be on CTV morning live show. And so we will be there and we'll be conducting fitness classes on there, not only for our members, but for whoever watching CTV in the morning. And we did some other not selling it, but giving it away, other fitness packages and recipe packages. So we're getting people, you know, a lot of times people are just eating junk food. So we're trying to get them to also focus on the other aspect of, you know, you can come to the gym, but also abs are made in the kitchen, not in the gym. So you're going to have to try and figure out the nutrition part of it too. So we've been giving a lot of free resources. And outside of that too, we're big on community. I'm sure you're aware of that. So we are, you know, every single month we try to do something for our community of Regina and Saskatchewan as a in whole. But I'm trying to think. We did a Carmichael outreach drive for clothing, so we got all of our members to donate some clothing, and we dropped off, I don't even know, probably 2-3 truckloads of clothing worth off for them. Food. December we did a blood drive, so we got a lot of our members to go and donate blood. We sold. We haven't paid them yet, but we collected a lot of money, not a lot, but some money for, we ordered a shipment of sweaters, and proceeds of those are going to be going to the Humane Society.
Oh, wow.
So we did that. And then so this COVID came, and one of our members works at the women's shelter, and she was just kind of, we're just chatting back and forth on, you know, some of the issues of them, because some of these, you know, some people's homes are not a happy place. And the home is kind of, you know, where they don't want to be the most. And an outfit of, you know, being in the gym or being out in public is almost their best part of their day, because they're not trapped in the house with somebody who's potentially abusive. So we had all these wipes, and we found out that they were sending some of their participants, their people who are coming into the women's shelter, they couldn't house them there because they couldn't disinfect it properly. Mm-hmm. So we donated a bunch of our wipes. We, I think 3,000 wipes we donated to them. So.
Oh, wow.
So we're still trying to be active and still trying to give during a time when, we should be focusing on taking and trying to optimize on that. But, we're a very community-driven gym, and, just stems from my wife and I and our team as well. So they're all very community. A lot of those initiatives were their initiatives. So not our initiatives. We're very team, you know, whatever. If somebody's passionate about something, then we take on that initiative that they're passionate about, we try and help them execute it. So, you know, we're trying to still continue to give during this time and you know, not necessarily trying to take in anything in, but renovate our clubs, make them look good so that when we do open again, it's going to be a fresh perspective a little bit, and you'll get that new paint smell when you walk into the clubs. You know, a lot of things that people won't really notice being here, but on our back end, we'll notice it because it'll make our systems a little bit easier and whatnot. So just kind of tinkering those small things have been keeping us busy here.
That's awesome, man. Hey man, I commend you. That's really good giving back to the community and yeah, thank you for the hard work that you and your wife are doing and your team are doing at Anytime Fitness. The fact that you guys are, you know, thinking of others and thinking of other organizations and just the fact that person was just a member at the gym. And then you guys, you know, were helping out, you know, more vulnerable populations, especially people. I think that quite often that narrative gets forgotten, right? I mean, that there's people out there in worse circumstances, you know, not only the essential staff that, you know, your police and your healthcare workers and all of those kinds of things, but the people that are going through rough situations and rough relationships or children that, you know, use school or anybody who's in a relationship that is abusive and you know, the best part of their day, just like you talked about, was getting out of the house or going to work or going to the gym. So the fact that you're, you know, in your guys' way helping out the community, I definitely commend you guys for that. And yeah, congratulations on all that hard work. And yeah, keep that stuff up. It'll definitely come back around to you, bro.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, we also tried our outreach to frontline health workers as well. We try to donate our entire gym equipment to them, and just not an option right now during the pandemic.
Right.
All gym facilities are closed, so we weren't even able to have a public gathering of people working out to use our equipment. So it makes it good for us, I guess. We have the best quarantine situation. We get to self-isolate in a gym and then go home and eat. So we have a whole gym to ourselves and get a workout in, but you know, a lot of people are itching. We see a lot of people walking outside, walking their dogs. And so it's good for the dogs too.
Yeah, no kidding. Well, I'm guessing if your wife gets sick of you, you can just go to the East End gym and she'll go to the North End gym and you can just have your own workout.
That's exactly, yeah. So if she ever does get sick of me, then that's exactly what we'd be doing. But so far she's been, she's been leading me around and telling me what to do. So it's good. And I'm not sick of her. So I hope she's not sick of me because she keeps on bringing me back.
Now, there we go. Right. Nice. The old saying, happy life, happy wife, happy life. That's what it is. Yeah. All right, man. Well, I want to thank you again for joining me. Thank you. And I can't say enough good things about you, your wife, your all of the stuff that you guys are doing is amazing. And we'll definitely, when we put this out, go check out Anytime Fitness on their website. You can go find them on Instagram and on Facebook. And again, thanks a lot, Jake.
Thank you.
Okay, man. You take care. Yeah, man. Yeah. You take care and enjoy your weekend and stay safe.
You too.